Alright, hello class. Today we're going to look at lesson 25, which is on trig functions at any angle. Okay, so what we have right now is the right triangle definitions, right? So where we build all of our definitions out of a right triangle. But the problem is we can actually evaluate, say, things like sine of 180 degrees, or cosine of like 225 degrees. All right, so the question then becomes, how do we do that? Because it's not like we can actually set up a right triangle with those angles, right? Because with theta in a right triangle, it has to be, will have to be definitely less than 180, because all of the angles in a triangle will sum up to be 180. Okay, so we can't actually use the right triangle definitions to do things like this. So we need a further definition. So we need to look at our trig functions at any angle to sort of expand this. Okay, so what we have is that if the terminal side of theta crosses through the point x comma y, then sine theta is going to be y over r, cosine theta is going to be x over r, and tangent theta is going to be y over x, where r is the square root of x squared plus y squared. So to give an example of what's happening here, right, if we have a point, I'm going to put it in the quadrant 1 here, but if we have an xy, and I make an angle, and we always go from the positive x-axis when we do this, okay, theta, what we're told is that, say, sine of theta is y over r. Well, if we make a right triangle here, okay, and say that this length is x, and this length is y, well, this does sort of match what we know. Sine of theta would be opposite, which would be y, over hypotenuse. Well, is that r our hypotenuse? Well, remember, by the Pythagorean theorem, r squared will equal x squared plus y squared. And when we take the square root of both sides, we'll get r is equal to the square root of x squared plus y squared. Notice I'm not doing plus or minus here. There's a reason for that. Mainly because this is always, this distance here, we always want to be positive. The hypotenuse, we always want to be positive. But the nice thing about this is it's going to work no matter what my angle is. So actually, if my theta takes us into quadrant 2, right, so here's my, let's say my new theta, I'll call it theta 2. Let's say it takes us to this point, which might be, say, negative 3, 2. Okay, we can still find trig functions of this angle, okay, using this formula. So it doesn't have to be in this first quadrant where we can make the right triangle, okay? So actually, let's look at an example of this to show sort of what's going on. Okay, let's say we have the point negative 4, 3, and our angle theta takes us from the positive x-axis to the terminal side here at this line. Okay, that so that the terminal side goes through the point negative 4, comma 3. Okay, so by the definition we started with here, where that sine is y over r, cosine is x over r, tangent is y over x. Okay, what we're going to get is, you know, negative 4 is our x, 3 is our y, and all we need to do now is find our r. Well, the r is going to be the square root. It's x squared plus y squared. So it's going to be square root of negative 4 squared plus 3 squared. Right? So it will be the square root of 16 plus 9. So that's the square root of 25. So r is equal to 5. Okay, so the length here is equal to 5. Okay? All right, now, from here, we can find sine theta. Sine theta was going to be y over r. Well, y is 3. R we found is 5. Right? Cosine theta will be x over r. X, and here we go. X is negative, so make sure you incorporate the negative. Right? So it'll be negative 4/5. And, you know, we usually drop that negative on the outside or up top. Okay? And then tangent, which we don't actually need to find r for, that's just y over x. That's going to be 3 over a negative 4, or we would usually say negative 3/4. Okay. All right, now we can find our other trig functions. So notice I didn't give the definitions of, say, secant, cosecant, cotangent and all that, but we could do that. If cosine is x over r, secant, which is cosine flipped over, will be r over x. So it will be negative 5/4. Okay. Cotangent is tangent flipped over, so it will be x over y. So it will be negative 4/3. And then cosecant is sine flipped over. Okay, so if sine is y over r, cosecant will be r over y, which is 5/3. All right. So there we go. We found all the trig functions of this angle. Now, something to note here. Since we're basing this off the xy plane, right? And we notice that we actually get negatives for some of these, right? Here, sine was positive, cosine was positive, tangent was negative, etc. So, based on that, the way our points go in quadrant 1, right? Since our points are positive-positive, everything's going to be positive in quadrant 1. Okay? And let me actually give us a blank axis to work with. Okay, as I said before, quadrant 1, all of our points are positive-positive, so all of our trig functions are positive. Right? So sine in this quadrant, cosine, and tangent are all going to be positive. Okay. In this quadrant, quadrant 2, the x-coordinate is negative, but the y-coordinate is still positive. So in quadrant 2, I believe we talked about this in one of the other lessons, why we named our quadrants this way. They follow the angle, right? The positive direction for our angle is counterclockwise, and we label our quadrants based on how the angle travels from the positive x-axis. Okay? Quadrant 3 is negative-negative. And then quadrant 4, our x-coordinate is positive, but our y-coordinate is negative. So that's quadrant 4. All right, now, so here we had that all of our trig functions are positive. Here, sine, okay, if we're in quadrant 2, well, sine was y over r, so it will still be positive. But here, cosine will be negative, and actually tangent will be negative. Okay, we found that with the example we just did. Here, you had sine was positive, but cosine and tangent were negative. All right, now, in quadrant 3, both components of the point are negative, so sine will be negative, cosine will be negative, but tangent will actually be positive, because remember, tangent is sine over cosine, so if we take a negative divided by a negative, it will come out to be a positive, okay? And then, in quadrant 4, our x-coordinate is positive, but our y-coordinate is negative. So for the y, our sine will be negative. Cosine, which comes from the x-coordinate, is positive. And tangent will be negative once again, since these are opposite. Okay? Now, the ways you remember this are you either remember that we're talking about points in a quadrant. So if you remember that your point's x, y, that the x is associated with cosine and the y is associated with sine. Okay? Or there's a little mnemonic device that helps sort of people remember this, and it goes all students take calculus. Okay? And so what this mnemonic device helps with is it tells us which trig functions are positive in each quadrant. So in quadrant 1, all three are positive. Second quadrant, students, only sine is positive. And take, only tangent is positive in quadrant 3. And then calculus, only cosine is positive in quadrant 4. So if you remember all students take calculus, even if you're not going to, if you can just remember that little acronym there, that can help you really quickly just like know when these functions and where they'll be positive. And then I noticed we didn't bother writing the other three, but the other three are based on these three. So like for instance, if all three are positive here, then the other three are positive. If only cosine is positive here, then only secant will also be positive in quadrant 4. Okay, so that's going to help us keep certain things like this straight. All right, so let's put some of this information together that we've just sort of come up with. We want to find the other trig functions. If cosine is equal to 12/3 and theta is in between 270 degrees and 360 degrees. Okay, so first of all, let's talk about this. 370 degrees between 360. Well, 360 is our full rotation, and 270 is right there. So between 270 and 360, our theta is in quadrant 4. So if we remember all students take calculus, cosine will be the only trig function that's positive in quadrant 4. So all of the other ones are going to be negative. The other thing we have, okay, is that if cosine is 12/13, this is our x over r, okay? Which gives us that x is equal to 12 and r is equal to 13. Okay, so we need to find r y if we want to find everything else. So we'll apply the sort of Pythagorean identity idea, the Pythagorean theorem, that r squared is equal to x squared plus y squared. Okay, so we have that r is 13. X is 12, 13 squared is 169. All right. And of course, 12 squared is 144. So we get that y squared is equal to 25. So y is equal to, now we have to be careful here, because before we ignored the plus or minus, but here, if y squared is equal to 25, that means y is equal to plus or minus 5. Now we're in quadrant 4. Okay? Y is negative here. These are points that are of the form plus, minus. So we're going to choose minus 5 for y. Alright, so we're going to choose the negative because we're in quadrant 4. Okay, so we do have to be careful about that. If you don't do your plus minus, you'll get things wrong. But if you didn't, if you just picked y to be 5, when you went to find sine, you would need to negate it to fit the quadrant. So as long as somewhere you make sure things are negative to make sure you're in the right quadrant, you should be okay. Just make sure you do that. Okay, so now we have everything we need. We've got our y. So sine, which is y over r. Well, r we found was 13, so let me write this as our x over r for our cosine value. So sine, which is y over r, will be negative 5 over r, which was 13. Okay, and tangent. Will be y over x, and y is negative 5 over x, which is 12. Okay, then we can just flip all these values to find everything else. Okay, so secant theta we know is cosine flipped over. Alright. Cosecant is negative, or 13 over 5, because it's sine flipped over, and cotangent will be negative 12 over 5, since it's tangent flipped over. Okay, and there we go, we found everything. So this, just put together the other definitions we have for cosine and sine, and put together what we know about the quadrants. Okay, so here I'm going to say that tangent theta is equal to negative 1/9 and sine theta is positive, and I just want to find sine and cosine. Okay, we won't find everything, but we could if we wanted to, but before we move on to the next topic, let's just find cosine and sine. So we have tangent. Now remember, tangent is y over x. Negative. So we have negative 1/9. So y is 1, x is 9, but where does the negative live? Okay, where does the negative go? Does it go with the 1 or the 9? Okay, well, that's where we're going to use this piece of information. And the fact that r is always positive. So if sine is positive, okay, and it's the only one that's positive, because we're not in quadrant 1, because tangent is also negative. So if sine is positive and tangent is negative, sine, remember, is x, and I keep doing that, y. Sine is y, sine y. Sine is y over r. So if sine, and r is always positive, if sine is positive, that means r and y must both be positive. Y is our positive 1. So the negative is going to go with the 9 because the y, the 1, has to be positive. Okay? So y will be 1, x will be negative 9. Okay, so we've got to be careful about that. And I only knew that because, and this is all because sine is positive. Okay, if sine is positive, that means we're in quadrant 1. Or, I'm sorry, quadrant 2. Okay? Alright, now that we have this, we can find our r. R is always going to be positive, so we don't have to go through the Pythagorean theorem step, the distance formula step. We can actually just go straight to the square root. So it would be square root of x squared plus y squared, which will be square root of negative 9 squared plus 1 squared. So r is equal to 81 plus 1. So r is the square root of 82. Okay. So when we use this, here's the thing you need to be should be careful about. Sine theta is going to be x over r. Well, we found that x was, sorry, I keep doing that. Sine is y over r. Okay? And notice I keep misspeaking there. It's a very common mistake to think that sine goes with x. You almost expect it to, since we usually talk about sine first and cosine second, but mind it's opposite. Sine always goes with the y. Okay, sine goes to y, cosine goes to x. So sine theta is going to be y over r, and y we found was 1, and r is the square root of 82. Now when you do this, the directions are likely going to tell you to rationalize, so we just go ahead and multiply the top and the bottom by root 82. So I get square root of 82 over 82 is sine. Okay, then cosine. Now this one's actually x over r. Okay, and x we found was negative 9. So we'll have negative 9 over square root of 82, which is our r. And once again, we'll rationalize by multiplying the top and the bottom. And so we'll get negative 9 square root of 82 all over 82. And that is that. Okay, so, and then from there we can find all the others by flipping things around, but that is how we would find sine and cosine given this limited amount of information. Okay, so we're just putting everything together that we have. Alright, let's look at something that this definition gives us. So here, we're looking at the point 1, 1, and that actually gives us an angle of 45 degrees. Which kind of makes sense. We're cutting this completely in half if we're going 1 to 1, right? I didn't draw that extremely well. Better. Alright, so we have a 1 by 1 triangle, which means our r will be square root of 1 squared plus 1 squared, so root 2. Okay? So there's our r, square root of 2. Alright, so with this setup here, sine of 45 degrees, which you probably saw this in a special triangle for your previous homework in the last lesson, and sine, which will be x over r will be 1 over root 2. We don't usually leave it like that. We're going to rationalize. So we'll multiply both the top and the bottom by root 2 and get square root of 2 over 2. Okay, so actually I'll move this over here and say sine of 45 degrees is square root of 2 over 2. Well, guess what? So is cosine. Cosine will be x over r. So it will be root 2 over 2. All right. If we go over to quadrant 2, and we look at the point negative 1, 1. Let me zoom out a little bit. Okay. Now we're at the point negative 1, 1. We're in quadrant 2. Now if I look at sine of 135 degrees, so 135 degrees will actually get us there. In fact, also when we calculate r, it will be negative 1 squared plus 1 squared. So once again, r is root 2. So sine of 135 degrees, well, sine is y over r, we're going to get 1 over root 2. Oh, well, that's what we've had over there, square root of 2 over 2. It's the same value. Okay. And then cosine of 135 degrees, well, that's also going to be our x over r in this case. And the only difference is our x is now negative, so we'll have negative 1 over root 2. So cosine is negative root 2 over 2. Notice that's the same values we got over here. The only difference is cosine was negative. And that's because we're in quadrant 2. Now here's the trick. 135 degrees, if I finish this off and get a nice straight line, you know, nice straight angle, the angle that's left here is 45 degrees. So notice that the values for sine and cosine, and for tangent too, tangent here would be 1, tangent here would be negative 1, the sine and cosine values come out to be the same. But except for a plus or minus based on this leftover angle here. This is called a reference angle. Okay. Now what's a reference angle? Well, given any angle, it's the acute angle made with the x-axis. Okay, well, this got very messy here. Let me write this on a different sheet here. Okay, so a reference angle of any angle theta is the acute angle made with the x-axis. Okay, acute. If you don't remember what an acute angle is, that's between zero. We're going to call our reference angles, instead of theta, we're going to use phi, which is like a circle with a dash through it, if you've not seen that before. That's what an acute angle is. So the smallest possible angle we can make, okay, with the x-axis. So if we're in quadrant 1, right, so theta is in quadrant 1, when we make our reference angle, it's also going to be in quadrant 1, right? So here, phi and theta are going to be the same thing. So we don't really need reference angles in quadrant 1. So not needed in quadrant 1. In quadrant 2, right? quadrant 2, if this is our theta, our reference angle phi is this one that continues on to the x-axis. And I should not use theta again. It's phi. Okay. And how we find it is theta plus phi is going to be 180 degrees. This is in quadrant 2. In other words, phi is going to be 180 minus theta. Okay, if you're in radians, so or theta plus phi is going to equal pi. So phi is equal to pi minus theta. All right. Now, if you're in quadrant 3, right, so here's our quadrant 3, and now phi, so this is our theta, to make an acute angle with the x-axis is going to be this one. So phi is right in here. And what is going to be is notice that theta goes 180 degrees, then it goes another phi. So if we go 180 degrees plus phi, we'll get all of theta, which means in this case, phi equals 180. Looking at the wrong thing. It's theta minus 180 degrees. Okay, so check this out. If we're in quadrant 2, it's 180 minus theta. If we're in quadrant 3, it's theta minus 180. You can do either, and if you get a negative, just ignore it. I mean, that's the idea here. If you get a negative, ignore it. And then if we're in radians, right, it'd be minus pi. So actually in quadrant 2 and quadrant 3, you could just do phi is equal to your theta minus 180 and just take the absolute value, right? Just knock out the negative. All right, then the only difference is then quadrant 4. So if you are in quadrant 4, here's your theta, your phi is going to be this angle here, right, between your angle theta and 360 degrees. Okay. So in this case, much like the quadrant 2 case, if I take theta and I add phi, those two angles together is a full 360 degree rotation, and so phi would be 360 minus theta. And then if we were in radians, phi would be 2 pi minus theta. So how I keep this in my head, how I remember all this stuff, is quadrant 2 or 3, just subtract 180 or subtract it from 180. If you're in quadrant 4, subtract 2 pi. Okay? Now, the reason all of this is helpful is because once you have a reference angle, once you have phi, I'll even write it in red, once you have phi, then sine of theta, or cosine of theta, or tangent of theta, or any of these values of theta are going to be sine of phi, cosine of phi or tangent of phi plus or minus. They might be the same, they might be negative, but where that, so where the plus or minus is determined. Quadrant. Okay. This isn't really going to be all that helpful until we know some nicer values of sine and cosine and tangent, but let's just find a couple of reference angles. All right, just to see. Alright, let's find the reference angle for 200 degrees. Well, first we need to find where 200 degrees is. So 200 degrees, alright, well, here's 0 degrees, here's 90 degrees, here's 180 degrees, here's 270. Okay, so 200 is in here somewhere, right? It's between. So we're in quadrant 3. So our reference angle phi is going to be here. Okay. So what we're going to do is take 200 and subtract 180. Okay. So phi, shift this over, phi will be 200. Now we're in radians, 5 pi over 6. So here's 0 radians, here's pi over 2, okay, here's pi, so remember pi is 180, here's 3 pi over 2, and here's 2 pi. Okay. So 5 pi over 6, well, some, it would, if you want to try and find where, you know, what quadrant that's in, there's a quick way to do it for radians, okay? I'll show you that in just a second, but 5 pi over 6, 5 sixths, okay, that's less than 1, right? And it's greater than a half, because a half would be 3/6. Okay? Which means if we just multiply pi's everywhere, this means pi over 2 is less than 5 pi over 6, which is less than pi. So we're in between pi, halves, and pi. Okay? So you can actually just, if you don't think that way naturally, you could just say, oh, what's 5/6? That's less than 1. And greater than 0.5, so I know I'm in here somewhere. Right? We're in quadrant 2. So here's 5 pi over 6. Okay. Now, here's something really nice about radians. You might not believe that there's anything nice about radians, but here's the beauty about radians. I already know what the reference angle is. Not because I'm like a genius, not because I'm a some sort of crazy mathematician, I know that it's going to be pi over 6. Okay? Because this is something over, something pi over 6. Something, some nice number, pi over 6. Okay? And I know it's going to work like that because my phi, okay, in quadrant 2 is we take pi and we subtract our theta, our 5 pi over 6. Well, pi, okay, when I use pi, this is pi over 1. If I want to get this as something over 6, it's going to be 6 pi over 6. Okay? And when I subtract 5 pi over 6, I get pi over 6. Okay? Guess what? If theta was 7 pi over 6, I also know that the reference angle is pi over 6. Because for 7 pi over 6, 7 pi over 6 is in quadrant 3. Okay? So when I take 7 pi over 6, so let's call this theta 2 since we're doing the second one. So if I take 7 pi over 6 and subtract out pi, once again, that's 6 pi over 6. So I have my 7, no, I messed that up. I have my 7 pi over 6 minus my 6 pi over 6, and that's going to be pi over 6. So that is the beauty of radians, is that their reference angles are just going to be whatever it is over the denominator. So pi over 6. So if you had, I had 7 pi over 4. This is starting to get cluttered, so let me, when you say theta is equal to 7 pi over 4, okay? 7 pi over 4, I actually know that that's quadrant 4. So what we do there is we take 2 pi and subtract our theta. I need to call this phi. Okay, now 2 pi, instead of being 4 pi over 4, that's a 2, so it'll be 8 pi over 4 minus 7 pi over 4, and we get pi over 4. Okay, the reference angle for any sort of radian measure that's simplified down. It has to be simplified down. It's always going to be that pi over 4, pi over 3, pi over 6. Okay. For instance, if we did 11 pi over 12. Okay. 11 pi over 12, 11 twelfths is 0.9, so that's between a half and 1, so that's quadrant 2. So for our phi, we'll take pi and we'll subtract 11 pi over 12. And then get 12 pi over 12 minus 11 pi over 12. Okay, so that's pi. How it's going to work for, I would say, almost 100% of the time. And there might be some weird ones out there that don't work this way, but you might be thinking, well, hang on, 10 pi over 12 won't work that way, right? If you have 10 pi over 12, well, that's actually going to simplify. That simplifies down into 5 pi over 6, and then you would get a reference angle of pi over 6. Okay? So, okay, and I did find one that doesn't work that nicely. It's 7 pi over 12. When you subtract pi from it, you get 5 pi over 12. All right, so you do have to be a little cautious with the unusual ones. Like pi over 12 is a little different, though. Our main ones are over 3, over 6, and over 4, and those are always going to work that way. Okay? All right, so this finding reference angles is not going to be that helpful if we can't utilize it in some way. Okay, so here's how we're going to use it. What this tells us is that if we know our quadrant 1 trig values really well, we can find every trig value based on that. Okay, so here's our pattern for sine. Sine of 0 degrees is 0. Okay, sine of 30 degrees is 1/2. Sine of 45 degrees is square root of 2 over 2. Sine of 60 degrees is square root of 3 over 2. And sine of 90 degrees is 1. Okay, now these, you probably saw things like it on that special triangle on those special triangle problems that you did in the previous lesson. Okay? Now, I think it might be difficult to see what the pattern is based on this, but there actually is a pattern. Okay? If I rewrote 0 as the square root of 0 over 2, right, because 0, square root of 0 is 0, 0 divided by 2 is 0. Now, I rewrote this as the square root of 1 over 2. Here's our pattern, right? Going from sine of 0 to 30 to 45 to 60 to 90 degrees, okay, we always have the square root of something over 2. At 0, it's 0. At 1, it's 1. At 2, it's 2. At 3, it's 3. Okay, at 45, it's 2. At 60 degrees, it's 3. And at 90 degrees, we finish off our pattern with the square root of 4 over 2, which will be 2 over 2, which is 1. This is our quadrant 1 pattern. Okay? If you know this pattern, you know everything. You know all of the sine values, and at least for the nice ones. And so what I was talking about before, those nice reference triangle values, or the nice reference angle values, are for these nice values of our angles. I'll show you the radians in just a second. Okay? Once we have sine, cosine follows the same pattern, just in reverse. Okay? Because cosine of 0 degrees is 1. Cosine of 30 degrees is square root of 3 over 2. Sine of 45 degrees is square root of 2 over 2. Wrong sine. Cosine of 60 degrees is 1/2. And cosine of 90 degrees is 0. It's the same pattern, just in reverse. So if you know sine of all your angles in quadrant 1, all the nice angles, these are what we call the nice angles, you flip them around and you get the pattern for cosine. Then we can find everything, right? We can find tangent, because tangent is based off of sine and cosine. We can find secant, because it just flips all these things over. Notice that secant is going to have issues at 90 degrees. Okay, you'll get secant of 90 degrees is undefined. So this implies that secant of 90 degrees is undefined, because it would be 1 over 0, right? So some of these trig values functions are going to be undefined. Okay, now you don't need to know it, but this can actually save you some time, and that's the tangent pattern. But if you just remember that tangent is sine over cosine, you can still get everything. You don't have to go through this, you don't have to memorize this, but if you know it, it can be kind of helpful. So here's the pattern for tangent. Tangent of 0 is 0, since it's sine over cosine, 0 over 1. Tangent of 30 degrees, when you simplify it down, it's going to be root 3 over 3. Tangent of 45 degrees will be 1, since it's sine over cosine, and the 45 degrees is when they're equal, so you get 1. Tangent of 60 degrees is root 3, and tangent of 90 will be undefined since it's sine over cosine, 1 over 0. Alright, so you gotta be careful with the dividing by sine, dividing by cosine thing. Okay, so if you know these, you are in good shape. Okay, and that's because we can base any other angle we want on these. Okay, these quadrant one patterns. Now, here's the really nice part about this. If I do my radian pattern, so I do that in the next step. Alright, if I'm in any quadrant, if I'm talking about sine and we're in radians, if it's a k pi over 6, I automatically know, using a reference angle, that we'll have plus or minus sine of pi over 6. Okay? So just dividing by 6, as long as this doesn't, you know, cancel or simplify, it's going to come out to be plus or minus 1/2. Okay? Having a k pi over 4, or something pi over 4, I automatically know it's going to be plus or minus root 2 over 2. It's a k pi over 3, I automatically know it's going to be a square root of 3 over 2, plus or minus based on the quadrant. Okay? That is the nice thing about radians. If we have our nice angles, our pi over 6, our pi over 4, our pi over 3, we automatically know what we're going to get. Okay, based on the quadrant, based on just these properties of sine and cosine. Okay? Alright, the other ones, any multiple of just pi for sine will be 0, and any multiple of pi over 2 will be a plus or minus 1. Right, based on what this value is. Okay, so let's look at some examples of using reference angles to help us evaluate some trig functions. Okay, and that should be it for this particular lesson. I know this one's kind of heady, it's got a lot of stuff in it, but and we're going to be putting a lot of this stuff together, but we're almost done. Okay, let's find sine of 210 degrees. Sine of 210 degrees. Well, 210, that's greater right, 210, that's greater than 180, but less than 270. Okay, so we are in quadrant 3. Right? So to find our reference angle, we're going to take 180 and subtract it from our theta. Notice I actually just wrote the 180 first. You could do that as long as you just ignore if you just ignore the minus sign. All right, you'll still come out strong. So 210 minus 180, that's 30 degrees. So I know that this is going to be plus or minus sine of 30 degrees. Now, which one am I going to choose? Since we're in quadrant 3, all students take calculus. So sine is actually negative in quadrant 3. So this will be minus, okay, and I chose that because we're in quadrant 3. So it's going to be minus sine of 30 degrees. So it will be minus sine of 30 degrees is 1/2, so we'll have negative 1/2. Okay, that is how we use a reference angle to help us evaluate a trig function in some other quadrant. Okay, here's an interesting one. 960, tangent of 960 degrees. Well, 960, that's actually past 360, right? We've gone all the way past 360 and gone another 600 or so degrees. So what we can do, if we're past 360, we can actually just start subtracting 360 as our reference angle. So tangent at 960 will be the same thing as tangent of 960 minus 360. So that will be the tangent of, that will be, what, 600 degrees? Okay, so tangent of 960 degrees will be the same as the tangent of 600 degrees. And we're still past 360. Okay, so what I'm going to do is tangent now of 600 degrees minus 360 again. So if you're ever above 360, just keep subtracting 360 till you get to something between 0 and 360. And so now I have a tangent of 240 degrees. Okay. All right. Now 240, that's back in quadrant 3 again. We're over 180. But before 270, so we're in quadrant 3. Okay, so quadrant 3, my phi is going to be 240 minus 180. So 240 minus 180 ends up being 60 degrees. So this is going to be tangent of 60 degrees. Right, which, if we remember our chart, and we need to be careful here. Right, if we remember our chart, tangent of 60 is square root of 3. But let's say we didn't remember that. Let's talk about how we would figure that out. I'll show that in just a second. But we need to take into account what quadrant we're in. So in quadrant 3, all students take calculus. So I'm actually going to choose the plus here, and that plus comes from quadrant 3, since tangent is positive from quadrant 3. So let's say you just didn't remember tangent of 60 degrees, but you remember that tangent is sine of 60 degrees over cosine of 60 degrees. Well, now you just put in the information that you have, right? So sine of 60 degrees, we know that's going to be square root of 3 over 2. Cosine of 60 degrees is going to be 1/2. We'll invert and multiply to get root 3 over 2 times 2 over 1, and the whole thing comes out to be root 3, which was what was on our table. Okay. So this is our basic idea of how we use reference angles to help us evaluate trig functions of other angles. And again, we're kind of employing a lot of our sort of previous information. A lot of geometry is kind of showing up suddenly. So, you know, take your time with some of these and kind of stretch back into your memory of when you took geometry for some of this angle stuff. Okay, let's look at another one. All right, sine of 7 pi over 4. Well, here's the beauty of radians. When it's a pi over 4, pi over 3, or pi over 6, I know automatically that this is going to be a plus or minus sine of pi over 4. And sine of pi over 4 is square root of 2 over 2. Okay, so I know off the bat that this is going to be a root 2 over 2. That is the, probably some would argue, the one nice thing about radians, but I would actually say that there's a lot of nice things about radians. Anyway, we need to choose whether this is a positive or negative based on the angle, what quadrant we're in. Now, I did say before I would give you a tool to help you figure out what quadrant you're in with radians, so here we go. For radians, quadrant 1 is just your normal quadrant 1 type angle, pi over 4, pi over 6. did tell you before that you could just look at the fraction and see where it lived, because this is 0, this is pi over 2, this is pi, this is 3 pi over 2, etc. Okay, in quadrant 2, the number on top is always one less than the denominator. One less than the denominator on the numerator. Okay? In quadrant 3, you're always one more. So it will be 5 pi over 4. Okay? And then in quadrant 4, okay, you're always one less. We can't just do one less. It's one less than double. Okay, so double of 4 would be 8, but we're one less than that. 7 pi over 4. And the reason we're one less than double, double, well, we're at 2 pi. Double, that would be 8 pi over 4, which would be 2 pi. Okay? All right. So, 7 pi over 4 we've already established now, but since the 7 is 1 less than double of 4, we're in quadrant 4. Okay, so, the only trig function that is positive in quadrant 4 is cosine, right? All students take calculus cosine, so we're going to choose the negative square root of 2 over 2. Alright, and there we go. Once we get this idea down, these with radians actually come out to be a little faster if you have these things in your head. Okay, let's start this problem here. Cosecant of 7 pi over 6. I'm going to put together a lot of things here. All right. So first, cosecant. That's sine flipped over. So this will be 1 over sine of 7 pi over 6. Okay. Next. Sine of 7 pi over 6. Using a reference angle, I know this will be plus or minus sine of pi over 6. Right. Then, I'm going to put together a couple more things. So first, plus or minus, well, let's go back to the thing we drew here to see what quadrant we're in. So 7 pi over 6. So 7 is 1 more than our denominator. So 1 more makes that quadrant 3. Okay, so we're going to use the fact that we're in quadrant 3 here to say that, well, quadrant 3, you know, all students take. Tangent is positive in quadrant 3, but everything else is negative. So this will be 1 over negative, and sine of pi over 6 is 1 half. Okay, so we'll move the negative outside, then invert and multiply to get negative 1 times 2 over 1, which comes out to be negative 2. Right, and there we go. We found cosine of 7 pi over 6 without needing a calculator. And so a calculator, of course, would give you negative 2 here, but when you start dealing with the square root stuff, it starts to get a little more hairy. Alright, that's it. I think I've talked enough. I think this one's gone on long enough. As always, if you have questions,